One of the criticisms that that appears regularly in the McChrystal report is that the current forces that we have in Afghanistan are actually worsening the problem, as you just alluded to, because of tactics that are our efforts for peace are being undermined by tactics that alienate civilians. One of the things my father said during the, you know, when he was opposing the Vietnam War during his, between 1965 and 1968, was he would ask people about the morality of this nostrum that we hear repeated again and again by the Republicans and other supporters of both of these wars, that we need to fight them there so that we don't have to fight them here. And he questioned the morality of that. He said, do we really have the ability to drop bombs on napalm on civilian houses in Vietnam so that we won't have to fight the communists in California? Are we, you know, and I saw last week, you know, when we captured these two or three domestic terrorists here in the United States, it occurred to me, you know, if we had information about one of these fellows and we knew that he was hiding in the Bronx, for example, would we take out an entire block in order to get to him?
Mm-hmm.
And you know, the answer is no, we wouldn't. Right. People in this country would be outraged if you bombed a block and killed civilians to get it, no matter, you know, what the danger was. And yet that's what we're doing every day with these drones that are operated by Blackwater and with a military response throughout Afghanistan, where, you know, we're destroying villages in order to get to a single terrorist.
And when we do that, when we launch an attack that kills a dozen, two dozen, 90 villagers, as one did just last month, are we really reducing the number of fighters, or are, as Donald Rumsfeld famously said, are we creating more fighters than we're killing? Are we spreading an anti-Americanism that will come back to defeat us? And this is, ties into the earlier point we're making. This is especially true if the population does not identify with the government that supposedly where they're defending. If to them this just looks like one band of armed men fighting another band of armed men, and it undermines the entire military strategy. Remember, and you remember this, Bobby, the South Vietnamese Army was the fourth largest army in the world. It collapsed 10 days after U.S. forces left South Vietnam. You can't erect and support this phony structure that's held up only by the presence of American troops. That's, I think, the country path we're on in Afghanistan, a war that I supported and I support all during the Bush presidency, but the current path we're on looks like a losing strategy to me. We've got to change course.
Now let's change subject for a second to talk about Iran, which I know is your true love. Iran fired medium distance missiles on Monday capable of hitting Israel. And the U.S. has responded to that and to this, these disclosures that about the refinement facility, the nuclear refinement facility near Guam, by taking kind of a hard line view on Iran. What has Obama done right, and what has he done wrong?
Well, he's done at least three things right. Number one, remember, he knew about this secret facility all along. It's like one of those movies where at the end there's this twist in the plot that makes you want to go back and look at what you just saw and reevaluate everything with this new understanding. President Obama was briefed by the intelligence agencies during the transition that Iran had these secret sites. We've known about these for at least a couple of years. So while he's engaged in his policy of engagement, while he's sending video announcements on the new year and extending the hand of friendship and giving Iran every opportunity to negotiate and come clean, he knows that Iran is lying and cheating and hiding these sites. The benefit of this engagement strategy, and this is the number one thing he did right, was that he united all the allies and our friends and other countries against Iran when this exposure is made. So it's probably the most unified front we've ever seen against the Iranian program. That's number one. Number two, he's still offering engagement. So while he's now brandishing a somewhat strengthened stick of sanctions, probably a UN resolution in December, and probably European and U.S. sanctions and financial restrictions in addition, putting the pressure on, I think that's right, he's also offering them a way out, that if you come, if you negotiate in good faith, if you allow the inspectors in, let us see everything, give us the other sites, and there are other nuclear shoes to drop, there are other secret facilities there, then we can work out an arrangement. And, you know, he's looking for a new relationship with Iran. He's willing to make a grand bargain, but not all at once, piece by piece. And finally, the final thing he's done, right, is his missile defense decision of a couple of weeks ago, where he scrapped, as they say, the Bush plan, which was unworkable, expensive, and wouldn't have been in the field for seven more years.
And alienated Russia and our other potential allies.
Right. Russia, who you need, and who is now with us, at least verbally so far, on Iran, and who's, if you're going to solve the Iran problem, you've got to have Russia with you for a whole bunch of reasons, including imports to and from to Iran from Russia on rocket technology, missile technology, and nuclear technology. So he replaced that, not just scrapping it, he replaced it nothing, which was the Bush plan, with something, which is Aegis cruisers and destroyers that are already in the Eastern Mediterranean, already have interceptors on them. He's going to upgrade those interceptors. That is probably our best working missile system, and it's designed to defeat not some imaginary Iranian missile, but the ones they actually have, the ones they tested in the last couple of days, including the Shahab-3 that can reach Turkey and Israel. So he's putting more military assets on station more quickly. That's another part of the pressure. I think he's got this about right, that the pressure and the incentives have got to be in a mix, and it's by judiciously doing both that your only chance of success comes, which is not to coerce Iran into collapse or compliance, but to convince them that their security interests, their prestige interests are better served in this non-nuclear path. That's the only way it's ever worked. No country in history has been forced to give up a nuclear program, but over a dozen have been convinced to do so. It's a convincing job with Iran, and Obama's handling it just about as well as you can handle it right now.
You know, a number of savvy critics have suggested that the administration has been overly bellicose, and particularly Hillary Clinton, have been overly bellicose in their reaction to the Iranians, and that that's counterproductive. One of the things that Scott Ritter said recently is that the Iranians have in fact, that people should go back and read the Nuclear Nonproliferation Treaty, and that the Iranians have not technically violated it. They reported on themselves, number one. Number two, that there's no evidence that they have a weapon. Should we be worried or should we not be worried?
Well, the last part is true. There's no evidence they have a weapon. There's no evidence that they're actually doing direct weapons work now. There's strong circumstantial evidence that they did do this in the past, particularly in the 80s and 90s. On the first point, I completely disagree. They are in direct violation of their treaty obligations. They signed an agreement with the IAEA, the International Atomic Energy Agency, several years ago, allowing inspectors to go to suspect sites to have access to many facilities, not just the declared ones, and that they agreed to declare there any plans to build a new nuclear facility. They unilaterally pulled out of that several years ago and declared it void, but you can't do that any more than you can unilaterally pull out of your cell phone agreement. AT&T or Sprint, you know, has a say in this, and the same is true in this kind of agreement. Both parties have to agree before the agreement is void. Iran's unilateral withdrawal is illegal, so they were obligated to declare this site. They clearly didn't. It's on a military base. This particular site is being built on a Revolutionary Guard military base, configured not for fuel fabrication, but fairly ideally configured for weapons material fabrication. That's all the bad news. The good news is even if they decided right now to build a weapon, it would take them at least a year to make the material, another year or so to fabricate. Most scientists believe they're 3 or 5 years away from a weapon. So we've got some time to try this diplomatic approach, tough direct diplomacy, and see if we can do it. And if that fails, you fall back to a stringent containment regime. the military option is not a real option. Secretary of Defense Robert Gates said just this weekend it wouldn't work. It wouldn't stop the program. At best, it buys you a couple of years, and it could start a third Middle East war.
Joseph Cirincione is president of the Ploughshares Fund, a global network of experts and advocates who are working to help President Obama create a nuclear weapon-free world. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much. I'm not one, two, I'm the one who, what you know.